to our continuing evening services. Thank you for coming. Hope you're in good singing form. Our first one this evening is Whenever I Am, Wherever I Am, I'll Praise Him. Wherever I can, I'll praise Him, for His love surrounds me like the sea. Tremendous love. It's just like the sea, no matter where you go, it's there. And the love of God is there whenever you seek Him. So whenever I am, I'll praise Him. Okay, let's read this together. Wherever I am, I'll praise Him whenever I can. I'll praise Him for His love surrounds me like a sea. I'll praise the name of Jesus lifted up today. Of Jesus for the rejoice and be glad in it. Let's sing this one again. You're singing well. Let's continue on with this. This is the day.
This is the day.
Because they haven't got the joy of the Savior in their heart. If you want joy tonight, you let the Lord Jesus come into your heart. Okay, let's really sing it out this evening.
If you want joy, real joy, wonderful joy,
not to sing again. But I believe the joy of the Lord is with us in these nights. His presence is here. And I believe God's joy will come into this meeting for someone tonight. If you want joy, real joy, let Jesus come into your heart.
If you want joy, real joy, wonderful joy, let Jesus come into your heart. If you want joy, real joy, wonderful joy, let Jesus come into your heart.
Let's sing out.
Your sins He'll wash away, and your night He'll turn to day. Your life He'll make it over and you, and then come in to say. If you want joy, real joy, wonderful joy, let Jesus come into your heart.
Okay, we'll stop and sing our first hymn this evening. There is a fountain filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's faith, and sinners plunged beneath that flood lose all their guilty sin. Tremendous gospel piece about the blood tonight. Let's stand and really sing it out. You're singing really well, and of course help the meeting so much. So let's stand and sing this great hymn together.
Bye.
Saxon theme for the church, redeemed, born again, going home, pilgrims looking for a land that is fairer than day. What a great confidence we have in scriptures to know that the Lord was to come back tonight, to have that peace. It would be absent from the body and present with the Lord. Do you have it? Do you have that hope? Is he your saviour? Is he your friend? Is he your king? If not, we trust and pray tonight that you will put your faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ and prepare for this great day of the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. We welcome each one of you. Thank you so much for coming along. We deeply appreciate it that you've made the effort tonight. It shows a hunger in your heart to know truth and to know certainty in uncertain times. We deeply welcome you in the Saviour's name. Do remember our final night of our series of meetings tomorrow, 8 p.m., whenever Reverend Colin Le Noury will be speaking on Is There Life After Death? Is There Life After Death? So don't miss it, and we'll be having another tremendous meeting of blessing with Colin Le Noury. Just at this point, I'm going to ask Reverend Maxwell if he would just open our meeting in a word of prayer, and then straight after this, we'll hand the meeting over to Colin.
Our Father, we thank you for the privilege tonight of being able to bow together in the attitude of prayer. And we thank you, our Father, for the provision that you have made for us in the Lord Jesus Christ, that fountain that was opened in the house of David for sin and for uncleanness. And we praise you, Father, for such a salvation, for such freedom, for such deliverance that's found alone in Jesus Christ. And we thank you, O God, that just as the message went out from the angels, that this same Jesus shall so come in like manner as you have seen him go. And we thank you that you are the returning Savior, and we look forward with great anticipation to that day when you will call us to rise to meet you in the air, if it's in our lifetime, and we have every reason to believe it could well be. And so, our Father, we ask you that indeed that you will bless your servant as he opens to us your precious word tonight. We pray that your Spirit might come upon him in a gracious way, and we ask you, Lord, that he will consciously know that God is with him, and that the Spirit of God is ministering to him, to our hearts. Lord, we thank you that your word shall not return to you void. And we pray, O God, that your word that goes forth out of your mouth tonight will indeed bring forth fruit to your honor and to your glory. So give the listening ear, we pray. Give the understanding heart, and give that obedient will to yield to the claims of Jesus Christ, even this very evening. So, Father, we commit ourselves to you tonight, and we look to you for each detail of this service. May your great name be honored and glorified, and we'll give all the praise and all the honor and all the glory to you even this evening, for Christ's sake. Amen.
Well, good evening. Lovely to see each one of you here this evening. Some of you have been coming night after night, and we thank you for that. Others are perhaps here for the first time. Well, we're very glad to see you, and you're very welcome indeed. Every one of you, as I said last night, is very special to me. You're special because you're here to listen to God's word. So thank you very much for coming, and it makes my reason to be here even more meaningful. So I'm sure the Lord will bless us as we come to his word this evening. I want you to turn with me to the prophecy of Ezekiel, chapter 38. If you have your Bibles with you, I hope you do, and you can follow me in the scripture, Ezekiel chapter 38. We're going to read a few verses from there, and we'll be studying those verses in a few moments' time. Commencing to read at verse 1. And the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech, and Tubal, and prophesy against him. And say, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against thee, O Gog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, and I will turn thee back and put hooks into thy jaws, and I will bring thee forth, and all thine army, horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armour, even a great company with bucklers and shields, all of them handling swords. Persia, Ethiopia, and Libya with them, all of them with shield and helmet, Gomer and all his bands, the house of Togarmah of the north quarters, and all his bands, and many people with thee. Be thou prepared, and prepare for thyself, thou and all thy company that are assembled unto thee, and be thou a God unto them. After many days thou shalt be visited. In the latter years thou shalt come into the land that is brought back from the sword, and is gathered out of many people, against the mountains of Israel, which have been always waste, but is brought forth out of the nations, and they shall dwell safely, all of them. Thou shalt ascend and come like a storm. Thou shalt be like a cloud to cover the land, thou and all thy bands, and many people with thee. Thus saith the Lord God, it shall also come to pass that at that same time shall things come into thy mind, and thou shalt think an evil thought. And thou shalt say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. I will go to them that are at rest, that dwell safely, all of them dwelling without walls, and having neither bars nor gates, to take a spoil, to take a prey, to turn thine hand upon the desolate places that are now inhabited, and upon the people that are gathered out of the nations, which have gotten cattle, goods, that dwell in the midst of the land. Sheba and Dedan, and the merchants of Tarshish, with all the young lions thereof, shall say unto thee, art thou come to take a spoil? Hast thou gathered thy company to take a prey, to carry away silver and gold, and to take away cattle and goods, to take a great spoil? Therefore, son of man, prophesy, and say unto Gog, thus saith the Lord God, in that day when my people of Israel dwelleth safely, shalt thou not know it? And thou shalt come from the place out of the north parts, thou and many people with thee, all of them riding upon horses, a great company and a mighty army. And thou shalt come up against my people of Israel as a cloud to cover the land. It shall be in the latter days, and I will bring thee against my land, that the heathen may know me, when I shall be sanctified in thee, O Gog, before their eyes. Thus saith the Lord God, art thou he of whom I have spoken in old time by my servants the prophets of Israel, which prophesied in those days many years that I would bring thee against them? And it shall come to pass at the same time, when Gog shall come against the land of Israel, saith the Lord God, that my fury shall come up in my face. For in my jealousy and in the fire of my wrath have I spoken. Surely in that day there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel, so that the fishes of the sea and the fowls of the heaven and the beasts of the field and all the creeping things that creep upon the earth and all the men that are upon the face of the earth shall shake at my presence, and the mountains shall be thrown down, and the steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground. And I will call for a sword against him throughout all my mountains, saith the Lord God. Every man's sword shall be against his brother, and I will plead against him with pestilence and with blood, and I will rain upon him and upon his bands, and upon the many people that are with him, and overflowing rain and great hailstones, fire and brimstone. Thus will I magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I I will be known in the eyes of many nations, they shall know that I am the Lord. May God bless the reading of his precious word, the inspired word of God, and I hope to be able to show you just how inspired it is as we study it in a few moments. Just want to take a moment to mention the bookstall in the foyer as you came in. On your way out, have a browse of that bookstall. It's just a small portion of the many books that we carry. We're very selective about the titles that we carry. We are a pre-millennial, pre-tribulational organization as far as Bible prophecy is concerned, and we choose books and titles that fit in with our belief, and you will find a selection of them there on that table. Just want to mention a couple of them which are in keeping with what I want to speak about this evening. This one is by Amir Safati, and it's called The Last Hour. The Last Hour. And in this book, Amir Safati helps us to see and to understand, as I'm going to share with you in a few moments, that we are indeed in the last days and that we are fast approaching the return of Jesus Christ. I've only four copies of that book. It's an excellent book, and it's first come, first served on those four copies. Another book which is in keeping with our theme in some way tonight is a book by Charles Gardner, A Nation Reborn. This is all about the nation of Israel and the rebirth of the nation of Israel in 1948, and the way in which God has worked among the Jewish people in bringing them about from all over the world, from the diaspora, the dispersion, and the regathering of them to the nation of Israel. But this book is full of anecdotal pieces as well. Charles Gardner is actually, he's a South African. He's a journalist by trade. He worked in Fleet Street. I know Charles, and he writes in a very special way, and he brings in a lot of anecdotal material, which makes the book a really excellent read. So I recommend that one, A Nation Reborn. It's all about Israel, and that's what our subject is going to be about tonight. And I just want to mention our magazine. This is the current issue of our magazine, Prophetic Witness. I've only one copy of this current issue, but I've plenty of back copies of the magazine, and you can take them freely tonight. They're absolutely free. Take them with you and read them. And if you like what you read, you will find a subscription form somewhere in these pages, and you can sign up for the magazine either in these meetings, and it's £30 for the year, or you can send in a subscription to my office, and we will get you on computer, and you can receive the magazine on a regular monthly basis. And I assure you, you will be blessed by what you read, and you will be illuminated by what you read. One of our main writers is a friend of mine, Tony Pierce, who writes on Signs of the Times. And Tony's articles are always very illuminating, and they help you to realize and to understand the days in which we are living and the fact that Jesus Christ is coming again soon. I've said that every night, I've said that in every meeting, and I say it again tonight. Jesus is coming again. Amen? Amen? Jesus is coming again. Let's hear it. Amen? Amen? Good. I'm glad that some of you have got it anyway. And I hope by the end of these meetings you all have it burning within your heart. So our subject this evening is Putin, Ukraine, and Bible prophecy. Let's pray before we look into the Word. Our gracious God and Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful book that you have given to us, the inspired Word of God. We thank you, Lord, for our Bible. We thank you, Lord, that you have given it to us to give us understanding of your plans and of your purposes. most of all to give us understanding of your great plan of salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Saviour, of whom we have been singing this evening in this glorious hymn. And we've been singing, Lord, about the wonderful assurance of salvation and of being saved to sin no more. And we look to that day, Lord, when our salvation will be final and complete when we enter into your glorious presence. But till then, Lord, help us to understand your plans and purposes. And as we look into your word tonight, we pray that your Holy Spirit will take hold of speaker and listener alike. And we pray that you will use all to your glory and to your honor. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, when I was here with you, it was 7 years ago, I discovered today, I did speak on this subject, which I'm speaking tonight, about Putin and Ukraine and Israel and prophecy. But I've elected to speak on it again on this occasion because we are 7 years further on, and I think that we are beginning to see things being fulfilled in the way in which I was saying to you 7 years ago. We're that much further advanced in the prophecy that we have here before us. And I hope to be able to, as well as covering a number of things that I said last time, and forgive me if you were here and still remember them, but apart from that, I hope to bring in some new thoughts which have arisen as a result of what we see happening in the world around us today. And I've chosen this subject because I wanted in these meetings to be entirely contemporary, and I wanted to touch on things that are going on in the world today, really happening, and that we will fix our eyes on and understand. Last night we were talking about the perilous times, and we were looking at all the things that are going on in the world today, and I hope you went away with that sense of realization that we really are living in the time prior to our Lord's return. And tonight, as we look at this subject of Putin, Ukraine and prophecy, I hope again that you will go away with that same understanding. Tonight we'll be in a sense a little bit deeper and a little bit more prophetic than it has been on the previous nights. But I hope that will just confirm to you that God is at work and God is in control, that this world isn't just going on in some kind of evolutionary pattern as the world would have us to believe, but that there is a God who created it all, and that all things happen under his sovereign will, and that he is in control of what is taking place and has been so since the beginning of creation, and will do till eternity comes again. Now, we're all aware of what's going on in today's world as far as Europe and the Ukraine is concerned. It was 9 months ago that we listened to the news bulletin that told us that Putin had invaded the Ukraine. I remember one of the members of our team phoned me up that morning and he said, "Have you heard the news today?" I said, "I haven't listened to it yet." And he said to me with some measure of excitement, he said, "Putin has invaded Ukraine." And I said, "Well, that's not a surprise. That's not a surprise. Because I think we are building up towards the prophecy which is laid out for us in Ezekiel chapter 38. And I think the invasion of Ukraine is not without significance as far as this prophecy is concerned. And I'm going to try and point out to you why I believe that to be so. So, but before I come to Putin and Ukraine itself, I want to just go through the prophecy that we have here before us in Ezekiel 38. This chapter is an amazing chapter. And as you read it, you can almost feel the events unfolding and taking place. Ezekiel writes with such clarity about what is going to happen at some point in the history of this world, how it will develop, how it will unfold, and indeed how it will end. So let's have a look at this prophecy this evening. Ezekiel 38 and verse 1, the word of the Lord came unto me. Now let me say tonight that what I'm sharing with you, it's not my thoughts. It's not the thoughts of man. It's not even the thoughts of Ezekiel who wrote it. This is the word of the Lord. I want you to understand that. That everything we're going to look at in this chapter is what God says. And it's what God says that really counts and really matters. And if God says something, then we ought to listen, shouldn't we? Should we? I think we should. So Ezekiel says, the word of the Lord came unto me, saying, Son of man, set thy face against Gog and the land of Magog. This is a prophecy directed at a man, at a person. And his name, in this passage, is Gog. History will reveal who Gog is. But for the moment, we are looking at a prophecy directed at a man, an individual, who is going to, as we shall see, lead a mighty force of various countries in an invasion of the nation of Israel, with the aim of destroying the Jewish people. Now let me say at this point that the Jews are God's own people. That's why I recommend this book that I showed you, A Nation Reborn. The Jews are God's own chosen people, and God has a plan for the Jewish people. And the reason why there's so much anti-Semitism today is because this godless world hates God and therefore hates his people, hates the Jew. And this man, Gog, that Ezekiel is speaking about here, he's going to be a Jew hater. He's going to be anti-Semitic, and he's going to want to destroy the people of God. How very foolish to set yourself against God. But Gog is going to do that. Son of man, set thy face against Gog, the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshach and Tubal, and prophesy against him. Now we need to ask ourselves exactly who Gog is and who the land of Magog is. Well, I'm going to say to you right at the very beginning that I believe that the land of Magog is Russia, as we know it today. Ezekiel is writing in terms which were known and current in his day. But of course, in the evolution of time, countries change their names. Areas are given different names. But if we go back and look at the history, we will discover that Magog is actually the land of Russia, the area occupied by the Russians today. And it would appear from what Ezekiel is saying here that Gog is the leader of that land, therefore the leader of Russia. Well, the leader of Russia today is Vladimir Putin. Whether he is the Gog of Ezekiel 38, we don't know. It remains to be seen. Maybe the Gog of Ezekiel 38 will be Putin's successor. I'm not going to make any false predictions on that. We'll just have to wait and see. But this is directed against the land of Magog, which we believe to be modern Russia. Further on in the prophecy, it speaks of it as being the land of the northern parts. We read that a few moments ago. And if you go directly from Israel, and all the directions in the Bible are taken from Israel and from Jerusalem itself. If you go directly north from Israel, you hit the land of Russia. If you go directly north from Jerusalem, you will hit Moscow, the capital of that land where Gog resides. So we are in very little doubt as to who this man Gog is. I have another book here, The End of All Things is at Hand. Are You Ready? By Dr. Richard Booker. And he has quite a lot to say on our subject tonight. And I just want to quote something that he says. I'll put this book on the bookstall. It'll be first come, first served if you want it. He says, historians and Bible scholars have traced the migration of Gomer, Magog, Tubal, Meshach, and Togarmah. These are all the names mentioned in Ezekiel 38. And discovered that their descendants settled in the geographic area of the Caucasus Mountains, north of the Caspian Sea and the Black Sea. Well, that's Russia today. In ancient times, these people were called Scythians. This is modern-day Russia. Their names have changed over the centuries, but the geographic location is the same. So this writer is very convinced from his study of history and his study of the migration of ancient peoples in years gone by that this prophecy in Ezekiel 38 speaks about the land of Russia. Gog leading a coalition against Israel. Let's have a look at who might be in that coalition. It says in verse 3, "Behold, I am against thee, O Gog, chief prince of Meshach and Tubal." And in verse 5, verse 4, he says, all of them will come with you, armies of horses and horsemen, all of them clothed with all sorts of armor, a great company with bucklers, shields, and all of them handling swords. And then he identifies who these people are, this alliance of nations with Gog. And he says there will be Persia, Ethiopia, Libya with them, all of them with shield and helmet, Gomer and all his bands, the house of Togarmah of the northern quarters and all his bands, and many people with thee. So what we have here is Russia leading an alliance of nations that are going to band together with one aim and one purpose, the destruction of Israel. Now, as we identify this band of nations, which we're going to do in a moment, we will discover that all of them are Islamic nations today. And there's no one who hates Israel and wants the destruction of Israel more than the Islamists. The Islamists hate Israel. They've been wanting to get rid of Israel ever since the nation was reborn in 1948. Let's have a look at some of the names mentioned here. He mentions Persia. Well, if you know your history, you will know that Persia is what we call Iran today. Persia changed its name in 1938 and changed its name to Iran. Iran is one of the nations which spits out the most hatred against Israel. They really, really want to destroy Israel. And Israel is conscious that Iran is one of their arch enemies. So Persia is involved. Iran will be involved. Then he mentions Ethiopia. In the time of Ezekiel, when he penned this prophecy, Ethiopia was an area south of Egypt which covered what we call both Ethiopia today and Sudan. And we know that Sudan, again, is very much in the hands of Russia. That the Sudan government gets all its arms and its help from Russia. They have an alliance with Russia. Then he mentions Libya. Well, again, Libya is tied in with Russia. There's an alliance between Libya and Syria, and Syria is very much in the hands of Russia. In fact, Syria provides Russia with the only seaport on the Mediterranean coast at this point in time, and that's strategically important. Then he mentions Gomer and all his bands and the house of Togarmah. Gomer and all his bands. We're talking here about the descendants of Noah, if you like. You can go back to Genesis chapter 10, and we read there about these very same names, Gomer and Togarmah, and so on. They were the descendants of Noah, and they were the ones that I mentioned before that migrated towards the Black Sea. And they occupied not just the area north of the Caspian Sea, which I mentioned before, but they mentioned that they occupied the strip of land all down past the Black Sea. It's that strip of land where all the fighting is going on in Ukraine today. It's the land which involves Crimea. And last time I was with you, I mentioned that the annexation of Crimea was very important for this reason. And I'll come back to Ukraine again in a moment. But all these are the countries which will be aligned with Russia in this alliance to destroy Israel, and every one of them will be Islamic. You see, they will share an aim with Russia. Russia is a godless country. We know that ever since the revolution, when it became a communist state, Russia has been anti-God and anti-Christian. You've all heard of the pogroms, you've all heard of the persecution of Christians, the imprisonment of Christians in Russia during the communist Soviet years. And we all know that the Jews have been the butt of Russia's hatred and anger all down the years. And it hasn't changed. It hasn't changed. The thing about Vladimir Putin is that he wants to recreate the old Soviet Union. Something happened in the late 1980s under the president of that time, Mikhail Gorbachev. They called it glasnost, which was openness in the Russian language as glasnost. They called it perestroika in the Russian language, which is restructuring. And a change began to take place under Mikhail Gorbachev. Vladimir Putin, who was an intelligence officer in the KGB, never agreed with what went on in those years of openness. And it's always been his aim and his dream to recreate the old Soviet Union as it was, to go back to the old days, to make Russia the imperialistic nation that it once was. And he's trying to do that at this moment in time. Now, I'm not sure how I just got onto that point, but let's get back to Ezekiel chapter 38, where we have this alliance of nations. Yes, I know what I was saying. They shared a common aim, and the common aim is their hatred of God and hatred of the Jewish nation. The Islamists have their reasons for hating the Jews, and the Russians, being anti-God, have their reasons too. But they find common ground. Isn't it amazing how different groups can find common ground and can come together? And they will come together in this alliance against Israel. Now let's see how this all unfolds. Verse 7 says, "Be thou prepared, and prepare thyself and all thy company that are assembled unto thee, and be thou a guard unto them. After many days thou shalt be visited. In the latter years thou shalt come unto the land that is brought back from the sword, and is gathered out of many people." Clearly the land we're talking about here is the land of Israel, the land of people gathered from many nations. And if you know your history, you will know that for 2,500 years, the Jews were scattered among the nations of the world. But at the beginning of the 19th century, a great regathering began to take place, and Jews started going back to the land of Palestine, as it was called then. And then in 1948, they called independence and called the land Israel. And this is what Ezekiel is predicting, you see. And he was predicting this 2,500 years ago. He was saying that Russia and its alliance of nations will come against the land which has been brought back and gathered together out of many people. And I want you to notice that he uses in verse 8 the phrase, in the latter years. In the latter years. And that same phrase is used in verse 16. It shall be in the latter days that I will bring thee against my land. So twice God says in the latter times, or latter days, latter years, he's going to bring these people against Israel. Now those of you who were here last night, you will remember that I did mention the phrase latter days, or latter years, or end times. And I emphasize that this is a phrase which occurs over and over again in the scripture and in Bible prophecy, and points us to the end times of this dispensation of grace, the church age in which we live, those days just prior to the return of Jesus Christ. That is the latter days. And this prophecy will be fulfilled in the latter days, just prior to Jesus' return to this earth. So it's a very important prophecy and a very significant prophecy for that very reason. Verse 9 says, thou shalt ascend and come like a storm. Thou shalt be like a cloud to cover the land. Well, it looks like there's going to be a pretty large and mighty army involved here. And when you look at the number of nations involved there, and I think Turkey will be one of them, the land of Togarmah is probably Turkey, which will break away from the NATO alliance and will find itself in the hands of the Russians. Indeed, just recently, Vladimir Putin and Recep Erdogan, the president of Turkey, had a meeting together. And you might have seen it on television. One of them put his arms around the other one's shoulder. I think it was Erdogan who spoke about Putin as my dear friend. My dear friend. So you can see the way in which Turkey is going. It is heading more and more into the clutches of Russia. And so there's going to be this large band which will come like a storm against the nation of Israel. Like a cloud, it says, all thy bands and all thy people with thee. You can imagine a huge invasion of tanks and armored vehicles coming from the northern parts. Of course, north of Israel today is Syria. Syria very much in the hands of Russia already. So you can see how everything is building up in such a way for this prophecy to be fulfilled. Could happen at any given time. Now, there's one other thing I would like to say about the timing of this. I happen to believe that the fulfillment of this prophecy will not take place until the church has been raptured. Now, for those of you who may not be clear on this, let me clarify that the rapture of the church and the second coming of Jesus Christ, whilst they are two phases of the same thing, are actually distinct events, different from each other. That there will be, as I understand Bible prophecy, I said it the other day, but there will be, as I understand it, a period of approximately 7 years before the rapture of the church. That's when all the Christians are caught up to meet the Lord in the air, and the coming again of Jesus Christ to the earth to establish his kingdom. And I think it's in that 7 year period between the rapture and the return of Jesus Christ that this prophecy will be fulfilled. And I'll show you why. I believe it will happen when Israel is at peace. Now, since 1948, Israel has never been at peace. If you follow the news, you will know that time and time again, we keep hearing about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. It's an ongoing sore that the politicians cannot resolve. There is this conflict between Israel and its neighbours. It's been there ever since the rebirth of the nation of Israel. Israel has never known peace. From the moment that it was reborn in 1948, almost immediately they were plunged into war. They were plunged into another war during the 1950s, the time of the Eden crisis. They were plunged into another war in 1967, the very famous Six-Day War. And they were plunged into another war in the early 1970s, what we call the Yom Kippur War, because that was the time when the nations came against Israel on the anniversary of Yom Kippur. And even since then, you've had this continued intifada, as they say, this continued struggle between the so-called Palestinians and the Israelis. And every now and again, you see it breaking out, and you see more conflict and more bloodshed. Israel does not know peace, and has not known peace yet. And yet, we are told here in this prophecy that this will happen at a time when Israel is at peace. It says in verse 11, thou shalt say, he's talking to Gog here, thou shalt say, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. Well, that's not Israel today. You go to Israel today, and you will find that there is a very distinct wall that separates the Palestinian areas from the Jewish areas. But he says, I will go up to the land of unwalled villages. I will go to them that are at rest and dwell safely. All of them dwelling without walls, having neither bars nor gates. So at some stage, Israel will have to be at peace. And that's when Russia and this alliance of nations will seize their opportunity. They will say, look, Israel is off their guard. They're living at peace. They're living in unwalled villages now. This is when we will strike. Of course, that's the way in which nations work, isn't it? And one might ask, when will this happen? When will Israel be at peace? Well, my understanding of Bible prophecy is that the Antichrist will come to the fore after the church is raptured. And one of the first things that the Antichrist will do is to establish a peace treaty with the nation of Israel. He's going to break it after 3.5 years. Daniel tells us all of that. We haven't time to go into it tonight. But Daniel says that he will make this peace treaty, 7 year peace treaty with Israel. He'll break it after 3.5 years. But I think sometime during that first 3.5 years, when that peace treaty is in operation, when Israel is relaxed and thinks that she is safe, is the moment when Gog and her allies will strike. And that's when this prophecy will be fulfilled. It says in verse 12 that they will come to take a spoil, to take a prey, to turn their hand against the desolate places that are now inhabited, upon the people that are gathered out of the nations. I spoke about that regathering of the Jews, which have gotten cattle and goods and dwell in the midst of the land. What that verse tells us is that Russia and its allies are going to look at the prosperity of Israel. They're going to look at how Israel has been so very prosperous, and they're going to come to seize that prosperity. And if you know anything about what's going on in Israel today, you will know that Israel is becoming a very, very prosperous nation. Israel has been transformed under the hand of the Jews. For hundreds of years, the land of Palestine, as it was in the hands of the Arabs and of Bedouin tribesmen. And they did absolutely nothing with the land. Mark Twain visited it in the 1800s. He called it a God-forsaken land. He called it a land of swamps. And he said, who would want to live there? And that's how Palestine was. But when the Jews came back, when Israel was reborn, then it has become a very prosperous nation. And Russia and its allies will see this prosperity and they'll want to seize it. Come to take a spoil and a prey is what Ezekiel says. And you know, nobody will come to Israel's aid. Oh, there will be those voices that will speak out a little bit. It says in verse 13, Sheba and Dedan and the merchants of Tarshish. We think the merchants of Tarshish is Western Europe. Sheba and Dedan could be Saudi Arabia. And all the young lions, well, that could be Britain, that could be the USA, I don't know. They shall say, art thou come to take a spoil? Hast thou gathered thy company to take a prey, to carry away silver and gold? They're going to speak out, you see. All the Western alliance of nations, they'll say to Russia, what are you doing? What are you trying to do? But they won't lift a finger to help. Is that reminiscent of something that you understand today? Just take Ukraine. Russia has invaded Ukraine. The West speaks out. Plenty of words. We'll impose sanctions. We'll stop them doing this. We'll stop them doing that. We'll send some arms, but we won't get involved. And that's the attitude that the West will take when Russia and its allies come against Israel. They'll speak out. They'll talk against it. They'll question. But they won't get involved. Israel will be on its own, but not quite on its own, because Israel will have God on its side. And if it were not for the fact that Israel has God on its side, the Russian alliance would probably destroy them. But as we shall see in this prophecy, that is not the case. So in verse 14, he says, therefore, son of man, prophesy again unto Gog. Thus saith the Lord God, in the day that when my people of Israel dwell safely, thou shalt know it. Thou shalt come from the northern parts, thou and many people, riding upon horses, a great company and a mighty army. God is repeating the prophecy there. And thou shalt come against my people Israel as a cloud to cover the land in the latter days. Well, people thought, you know, in 1967, when the Six-Day War broke out, that Israel was finished. And there were 40 million Arabs against just 2 million Jews in the land at that time. And the number of aircraft and weaponry that the combined Arab forces far, far outweighed what Israel possessed. And it really did look as if Israel was finished. I remember I was working for my father at the time, and my father was well into Bible prophecy. And one of the men working with me, he was an unbeliever, and I was a non-Christian at the time as well. And my father was telling us about what was going on, you know, the beginning of the Six-Day War on the Monday morning when the war broke out. And this other person who was working with us, he turned to my father and he said, Israel's finished. They're gone. And I thought the same, to be honest, but I didn't say it. And my father said, no, they're not. Because God is with them. You'll see. And indeed we did see. After 6 days, Israel had won that war. And that made a tremendous impact upon me at that time. And that brought conviction to me. It made me realize that Bible prophecy is absolutely true. And it had an impact and a means of leading me to faith in Christ. Now the situation will appear the same in this Ezekiel 38 prophecy. It will look as if Israel is finished, and people will say they've had it now. But no, God is on their side. And we see how the conflict unfolds. We are told in verse 18, it shall come to pass that when God comes against the land of Israel, saith the Lord God, that my fury will come up in my face. God will be angry with Russia and its allies. And he says, in my jealousy, that's jealousy towards Israel, his beloved and chosen people. Remember, the Jews are the apple of God's eye. He says, in my jealousy and in the fire of my wrath, says God, I have spoken. In other words, God says, I'm going to sort out this alliance of invading forces. And it says, surely in that day there shall be a great shaking in the land of Israel. I think, and Bible prophecy students think, that refers to a mighty earthquake. A great shaking in the land, a great earthquake. Which God will bring about, which God will use as a punishment against these invading forces. But it doesn't stop there. It goes on in verse 20 to speak about the result of that earthquake, that the fishes of the sea and the fowls of the air and the beasts of the field and all creeping things upon the earth and all men upon the face of the earth shall shake at my presence. Says God. And the mountains shall be thrown down, and steep places shall fall, and every wall shall fall to the ground. So God is going to intervene, divine intervention, at the moment when this allied force enters Israel. Then in verse 21, we read there about what we would call friendly fire. In military terms, they call it blue on blue, friendly fire. It says, every man's sword shall be against his brother. You can imagine this allied force made up of all these different nations. They all speak different languages. There's a communication problem there already. Then there's this mighty earthquake. They don't know what's happening. This is divine intervention. They don't know what's going on. And as a result of this, they ended up with blue and blue, friendly fire. They start shooting each other. And then we read in verse 22 that God will send disease upon them. I will plead against him with pestilence and with blood. So there's going to be an outbreak of some sort of disease which is going to overwhelm these invading forces. And then the final act of divine intervention. Upon the many people that are with him, there will be overflowing rain and great hailstones, fire and brimstone. Now, I don't know whether we take that literally, as fire and brimstone coming down from heaven, or whether that's the result of the reaction of the Israeli forces. And we know that Israel is a nuclear nation. And we know that Israel has many sophisticated weapons. And this could be the result of the unleashing of some of those sophisticated weapons. So this invading force will be roundly defeated on the mountains of Israel. But look what it says in verse 23, the last verse. Thus will I magnify myself and sanctify myself, and I will be known in the eyes of many nations, and they shall know that I am the Lord. You see, all the nations of the world are going to be looking on. All the Western Alliance and all the Asian nations and Australia and the African nations, they'll all be looking at what's happening. And when they see the destruction of these forces, they will recognize that this has not been a man-made one war. This has been divine intervention. They will recognize the hand of God in all of this. It will be known in the eyes of many nations. They shall know that I am the Lord. What a powerful prophecy we have here. Now let's come back to the Ukraine and Putin. As I said earlier, Putin may be the Gog of Ezekiel 38, or it may be somebody who succeeds him. We will simply have to wait and see on that one. But certainly the invasion of Ukraine has significance in all of this. Last time I was with you, they had invaded the Crimean Peninsula. And I said to you then that that was strategically important, because seizing the Crimean Peninsula meant that they had the port of Sebastopol. Sebastopol is one of the main deep sea ports on the Black Sea. Now, Russia, up to that point, did not have a deep sea port of that significance on the Black Sea. Why is that important? I told you last time that Russia's navy is split into three parts. There's the northern fleet, which is based in Severodvinsk over on the Arctic Circle. There's the eastern fleet, which is set on Vladivostok, away out on the east, over by Alaska, Japan, over that way. And then there's a small Mediterranean fleet on the Black Sea. If Russia is going to launch a major attack on Israel, it will happen not only by land, but the invasion will also take place by sea. Of necessity, it will have to include a naval invasion. For Russia to get its northern fleet from the Arctic Circle would have to go all around Greenland and Iceland, down the Atlantic, past Ireland, down to Gibraltar, through the gates of Gibraltar, and all the way across the Mediterranean. It would take them weeks and weeks and weeks. We remember how long it took our fleet to get down to the Falklands in 1982. It took weeks to get there. Similarly, if they were to move their eastern fleet from Vladivostok, they would have to come all the way down past Japan and past the Philippines, almost down to Australia, around Malaysia, across the Indian Ocean, and all the way up the Red Sea. That would take them a very, very long time. So Russia has no, until they seized Crimea in 2014, I think it was, they had no fleet that could be easily mobilized to invade Israel. But they seized Sebastopol, and now they have a deep sea port for their fleet of ships. Now, since then, they have enlarged the Russian Navy, mainly with corvettes and frigates. And they have positioned those in the Black Sea. And the reason why the present invasion of Ukraine is important is because it gives us, gives them the further access that they need. You see, not only are they satisfied with Sebastopol as a deep sea port, but you remember a few months ago there was a terrific war over Mariupol. Mariupol being another deep sea port. Kherson, which you've heard on in the news, is another port. And Odessa is on Putin's hit list, another deep sea port. What he's trying to do is to get all the deep sea ports on the Black Sea that will enable him to launch an attack on Israel in just a matter of days or weeks, instead of having to come all the way from the Arctic Circle or the Far East. He can move his troops from the Black Sea and he can be on Israel's border in absolutely no time. And that's why he's so keen on seizing those ports that we've seen him do in the last few months. But there's something more than that. If you followed the news, you will have noticed that he is trying to create a land strip all the way from Russia down to those ports. And the reason why he wants that strip of land is because he wants to be able to move all of his tanks and his armored cars overland to those ports. So he needs that access to those ports. He needs that strip of land. And that's what they're fighting over and have been fighting over in the last 9 months. He's not interested in the west of Ukraine. He's not bothering that. And again, just to remind the Ukrainians that he can do it, he'll throw a missile over the west, but he's really interested in that strip of land that leads to those ports, because those ports will be strategic in any conflict that Russia involves itself in the Middle East. And I see that as being very important in the build-up to the prophecy that we've looked at tonight here in Ezekiel 38. And whether it happens under Putin or happens under somebody else, I don't know, but I think the events of the last 9 months and this invasion of Ukraine is significant. We don't know how it will all end up. It is possible that it will end up with some kind of treaty or compromise. And it wouldn't surprise me. Now, I'm not going to make any false predictions here because I don't want to be labelled a false prophet. But it wouldn't surprise me, and I say that cautiously, if some sort of compromise is established in which that strip of land that I'm talking about will be given to the Russians, and they will be happy and contented with that. So you see, dear friends, we are living in momentous days. We are living in days of great significance as far as Bible prophecy is concerned. I think we can see how the words of Ezekiel 2,500 years ago are coming to life in our day and age. And if I am right that this will happen when Israel is at peace following the rapture of the church, it may be that the rapture of the church is very near indeed. In fact, it could be at any moment. The Lord could call his church to himself tonight. The Bible speaks about the trump of God, the voice of the archangel, and how in that moment every Christian believer will be caught up to meet the Lord in the air somewhere in the heavens. There will be a rendezvous point where we will meet the Lord. That could happen at any time. And if that happened tonight, then I suggest to you that what we've looked at here in Ezekiel 38 could unfold very, very quickly. On the other hand, we might have to wait several years. I mean, it's 7 years since they invaded Crimea to this present conflict. And there may be another stretch of time between the present invasion of Ukraine and the future invasion of Israel. We don't know the time, and we're not going to make any false predictions, but what we do know is that it is clearly predicted in God's word, and the world is in a prepared state for that. The world is ready for that to happen. Just a few weeks ago, an American admiral, Charles Richard, said this, referring, of course, to the Ukraine conflict. He said, and here I quote, "This is just the overture. The big one is yet to come, and it may not be far away." I suggest to you that the big one is Ezekiel 38. Now, as far as I know, Admiral Charles Richard is not a Christian, and I'm not even sure that he was thinking of the invasion of Israel, but I think his words may well be very pertinent at this point. And of course, Putin's hatred of Israel and the Jewish people, well, that's fairly well known and fairly common. Just a year ago, Putin said that the escalating war between Israel and the Palestinians is a threat to Russia's national security, end of quote. I don't quite know where Putin is coming from on that, but somehow he seems to think that Israel is a threat to Russia's national security. And when people feel threatened, what do? They react. And Putin is not beyond reacting, I can tell you that. So friends, we are living in momentous days. And I want to just say to you, if you're not a Christian tonight, if you've never accepted the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I just want to close tonight by saying to you, time may be short. We don't know how much time there is between now and the rapture. It's important that you be ready for that event. It's important that you be part of the body of Christ, caught up to meet the Lord and to be taken in his presence, rather than left upon this earth to undergo the wrath and the judgment that God is going to pour out. And we haven't time to talk about that tonight, but this world is coming under judgment. This Christ-rejecting world is going to feel the wrath of Almighty God, and you don't want to be there. You want to be among the saints of God. You want to be among those who are raptured and caught up into God's presence. And you can only do that by receiving Jesus Christ into your heart and into your life as your Lord and Savior. Let me tell you that Jesus Christ came into this world to save you. He died on the cross to take away your sin. And the Bible says very clearly that we are all sinners. We have all sinned. We've all come short of the glory of God. We've all broken God's laws. We all stand under condemnation until that point when we come to the cross. And in repentance, we ask Christ to take our sin and to forgive it. And you need to do that tonight if you haven't done so. You need to bow the knee humbly before the cross, acknowledge that Jesus Christ is your only hope and only Savior, that without him you are lost for all eternity. You will go to a Christless hell unless you receive Jesus into your heart as your Savior. Repent and acknowledge him. Acknowledge that the blood he shed cleanses you from sin, and receive him by faith into your heart and life. And do it tonight. Don't delay. We don't know how much time we've got left. There was an old hymn that brought me to faith in Christ many years ago, and it says, "Life at best is very brief, like the falling of a leaf, like the binding of a sheaf. Be in time." And that's true, you know. Life at best is very brief. You don't know how long you've got. You don't know how long till the Lord comes again for his church. You don't know how long you've got in your own personal life. You could have a heart attack tomorrow. Our life is like a vapor. It appears for a little time, then it disappears, and it's gone forever. It's important in this life that you settle your eternal destiny by believing and trusting in Christ as your Saviour. And I ask you to do that tonight. And not to leave this building, I emphasize with urgency, not to leave this building until you have settled the matter of your eternal soul. Trust in the Saviour this evening. I've talked about prophecy. I only talk about these things really to get your interest. What I'm most interested in is your soul's salvation. And I pray that you will seek the Lord tonight if you haven't done so. And the scripture assures us that they who seek him will find him. And if him that cometh unto me, the Lord says, I will in no wise cast out. If you come sincerely, repentant and believing, you will find acceptance with God and with Jesus Christ. Let's pray. As I've done every other night, I'm going to pause in silence and ask you to make your peace with God personally and privately, just where you are sat this evening. In the quietness of these few moments, I want you to, in your mind, to say a prayer to the Lord. Lord, I repent of my sin. I'm willing to turn from my sin. I want to trust you. I want your blood to cleanse me from sin. I want to be saved. I want to be saved. Come into my life tonight, Lord Jesus. Just say something like that, some sort of prayer like that, and however feeble it may be, God will see the sincerity of it, and he will answer that prayer. He will come into your life. You can start anew tonight. You can become a new creature. Old things will pass away. You'll begin a new life with Christ. And you'll be amazed how very different the new life with Christ is from the old life. And you'll wish you'd done it sooner. Come to the Saviour. Make no delay. Hearing his word, he has shown us the way. Do it now in silence as we bow before him. Lord Jesus, I pray for that man, that woman, that young person here in this meeting who has reached out to you in repentance and faith. I pray, Lord, that you will come into that life. And I pray that, Lord, you will do your work of grace and your work of conversion, that you will bring about that new birth which changes a person and makes them completely different. Give them that assurance of salvation and of sins forgiven. Let the Spirit of God witness to their spirit that they have become a child of God. Lord, to that end, bless any who have reached out to you in faith tonight. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Again, as I've said other nights, if you made that prayer this evening, and made it sincerely, do let somebody know, preferably let the pastor know what you have done, and he will be able to help you. The Bible says if we believe in our heart, and the prayer you've just made is the believing in your heart, we believe in our heart, and if we confess with our mouths the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved. So if you've done that believing part, you need to do the other part now. You need to confess. You need to tell somebody of the decision that you have made tonight under the promptings of God's Holy Spirit. So don't go away without making known the choice that you have made. And may God bless you. May God bless us all. Amen.
Can we thank Colin again for a very clear explanation of God's living word? Thank you for your attention tonight.
It's been excellent. I trust these messages have been a blessing to your soul. And if you're a Christian, I hope these messages aren't just information, but that they may lead to transformation. And that while we wait for Christ's return, that we might be working well for him. Jesus Christ said, "The night cometh when no man can work." What better way to work for the Lord than to invite someone to tomorrow night's meeting, one more meeting, think of someone and invite them. May the Lord bless you on your road home.